Idris.
And I'm Sharaad Kuttan.
You're watching Consider This, the show where we want you to consider and then we consider what you know of the news of the day. Our guest tonight is Tan Sri Syed Hamid Albar. During his tenure in government, he held several ministerial portfolios, including that of the Foreign Affairs Ministry and the Home Ministry. While no longer in government, he's still very active in politics today. He's currently the chairman of Bersatu's Party Election Committee. Tan Sri, welcome to the show. It's good of you to join us tonight. I'd like to begin our conversation, Tan Sri, by quoting Tricia Yeo, who's the CEO of the think tank Ideas, who recently wrote in an opinion piece, quote, "In recent years, Malaysia has turned increasingly inward as its leadership has had to contend with domestic politics. In short, Malaysia has given the impression that it cares very little about its external image and positioning. And this will make it very difficult for Malaysia to provide leadership on key regional challenges of today, for example, the Rohingya refugee crisis, South China Sea disputes, and more," end quote. Now, thank you. Based on this, do you think that Malaysia's decision makers have been so consumed by trying to address daily domestic crises that they've neglected issues of diplomacy?
Okay, thank you, Melisa, for the question. I think what is important in terms of foreign policy? Foreign policy is very much influenced by domestic issues, what's happening within the country. There is no doubt about it. But if you are facing an internal conflict or internal problems within the country, then your focus will tend to be on national issues. And even though the foreign policy issue is a very important issue, it may become sidelined or it is not seen. To me, I consider it very important during this time that we establish a very good communication so foreign countries would know what's happening in our country, and it's very transparent. So you will add in confidence to our perception of stability within Malaysia. You know, every country at present is facing all kinds of political problems. That's quite normal. But how you handle that political problem, how you project the perception of confidence, the perception we are handling this, we are tackling all the issues. At the same time, we are interested to make sure that our role, regional or international level, is still there. We are still very conscious, we are still very focused, because we want foreign investors to come and we want to deal with many issues, economic issues. When COVID hopefully will stabilize over a period, then we want to start and open up our economy again so that we can lead a normal life, even though it's a new norm. So I think at present, concern with local issues, the COVID pandemic is very serious. It has got three dimensions that we have to tackle. One is we have to tackle about the public health issue. We have to tackle about the economic issue. And thirdly, this third one is very important for our trajectory and confident perception of our political situation. That is our international relations. And that's where I consider that we must pay more attention to our international relations. There are a lot of good things that we have done during the COVID, handling of the COVID and outsourcing, but we must not be apologetic on what we are doing.
Tan Sri, you took over the position of Foreign Affairs Minister, you know, the late 90s, in 1999, I believe. And that was the kind of heyday of Malaysia's foreign affairs, you know, sort of push. It, you know, Malaysia was said to be punching above its weight. I think largely the effect of Tun Dr. Mahathir Mohamad's own leadership globally. Do you think we've come down from that position, that high that we used to enjoy in terms of global leadership?
I think definitely if you talk about putting it, whether we have come down, I think maybe we are not speaking much about foreign policy. That's the reason we feel in the sense of absence, Sharaad. We are not present because we are inundated with our own internal problems. We have the issue of 1MDB. We have then the issue of where we could have taken advantage and do very well when the euphoria of democracy in 2018, and then it becomes short-lived, that euphoria. Then we go back to, discussing, debating on legitimacy.
If I may interrupt you and follow up on that question. So what do you think is the current international perception towards Malaysia? What is brand Malaysia at the moment? And if I may hone in a little bit, what is brand Muhyiddin on the international platform?
I think on the international platform, due to the COVID, we are not able to be seen, because international relations, usually we move around. It is question of moving from one country to another, speaking to one. But there is an alternative to that. And I think the fact that there is COVID, the fact that we are busy with COVID, doesn't mean that we should not be engaging at bilaterally or multilaterally. And this must be made known on certain important international issues or regional issues. And we just cannot, not have an opinion. We must have an opinion on international issues. Say, for example, Malaysia now, if Sarah's question is we are going down, I think we are not good on our rating for governance, say, for example. We're not good at our rating on now the issue of rule of law, issue of democracy, issue of freedom, rightly or wrongly. But this is the time for us to speak and talk about our position and what we are doing. In corruption, we have gone very badly. So, I think it's our sense of confidence. What I'm saying is that with all these things, inundated, and we are, all these, we have got ramifications of this kind of thing, it is time for us then to show ourselves and speak aloud.
Can I pick up on the question of the Rohingya refugee crisis? Because the Malaysian government was mocked for its, during the time of Najib Razak, its really grand gestures of being in solidarity with the Rohingya people. And the Myanmar military mocked us, saying that, well, this was just playing to a domestic audience. And it seemed like with the turnaround that came a couple of years later, they were proven right, that in some sense, local politicians used the Rohingya issue to bolster their own self-image with really a lack of true sincerity in terms of helping the Rohingya. Do you take that criticism?
I think Malaysia is always known for the role that we played in championing the cause of refugees, cause of asylum seekers, in conflict areas. We are always there. But at this time, we tend to forget what we have done previously. There is no continuity. We have taken the position for the Rohingya. We are a member of OIC. OIC has played a very good role in bringing the whole issue of Rohingya until up to the ICJ. We don't come up front. It's a country like Gambia that comes up front. And then with the OIC support, we will come back. We'll come to it later. So I think this type of waiting to see what others do makes us not to be in the forefront of international issues. And refugees, we treat refugees as if we have no responsibility to the refugees. And yet Malaysia has done very well, even though we are not a signatory to the 1951 Convention. And yet we have accommodated, and we have been in, and now we are seen to be regressing and treating them as if they are common illegal migrants. Even though our law do not recognize them, we have always operated and worked together with the UN, the United Nations High Commission for Refugees. So it is this type of being upfront.
Beyond the Rohingya issue, if I may touch on the coup in Myanmar, what do you think is Malaysia's role in that?
This is a very complex issue. You see, in the case of the coup, during the time, Aung San Suu Kyi is definitely not the champion of democracy. But she won the election. And the coup came on the day that they are supposed to meet in to get the first parliamentary session. And the coup came in. And ASEAN, I think even and Malaysia, came out with a statement to say that we must try to solve the problem peacefully. You know, let the parties come together. I think in the situation of a coup, the parties never come together. They have put everybody in prison, and even Aung San Suu Kyi has been detained, and she's going to be charged for some, charges that are for possession of walkie-talkie, this type of thing. So it's not very serious. So I think now, if we want to play a role, we know that the military, they are not happy with the election result. But they seem to say that they support the democratic process. She didn't do very much in terms of democracy because minorities don't have a right. She excluded the Rohingya and all these things. So what we can do is actually to not to talk about personalities at present. We want democracy to be reinstalled. Because the situation today, when the military coup, is different from it was before. Now, there is civil disobedience. There is going the young are involved, and they are not interested to see the coming back of the military after being under military rule for 50 years. So I think if we do not handle, and ASEAN wants to stay at a sideline on the basis of consensus and non-interference, then we are going to get into trouble because it's going to be a bloody, this peaceful demonstration must be allowed, and we must encourage them to work out to restore democracy. And I'm worried that today you hear that one activist had been killed, a girl had been killed, 20-year-old girl had been shot. And I think it's going to get tougher, rougher, and this is not the type of thing that ASEAN should be, be keeping at the sideline. So I thought that Malaysia should be able to play a role to bring all the parties together. It's not easy because it's complex. But the military for the Rohingya, whether the military or Aung San Suu Kyi, it doesn't make any difference to them because. But I think now our fight should not be for the freedom of one person or personality. We should be talking about how do we encourage the military to bring back and restore democracy. And I think ASEAN is the responsible party. We can do sanctions, we can do all kinds of things.
Right. Tansri, we're going to go for a quick break, but please stay on the line. We'll come back and continue this conversation, particularly touching on ASEAN's policy of non-interference. So we'll continue in just a couple of minutes. Make sure you stay tuned to consider this.
Bila sentuh soal berita, tiada masa untuk tunggu. Kepada anda kami bawakan fakta, susulan dan kupasan yang terkini. Tiada drama dan tiada pengulangan. Usah tunggu lama-lama. AWANI 745, lebih awal dari biasa.
Kini berwajah baru.
Ini pula susulan khas pesawat Back Air di Kazakhstan. Pesawat berkenaan dilaporkan tergelincir dua kali.
Notifikasi berita terkini dan navigasi mudah. Podcast dikemas kini dengan berita dan program.
Rebirth, reformasi, resistance and hope.
Serta video tampil had dengan scroll tanpa henti. Buat turun aplikasi baru Astro AWANI sekarang.
Asrama Mahat Tahfiz Jabang.
Bila sentuh soal berita, tiada masa untuk tunggu. Kepada anda kami bawakan fakta, susulan dan kupasan yang terkini. Tiada drama dan tiada pengulangan. Usah tunggu lama-lama. AWANI 745, lebih awal dari biasa.
Kini berwajah baru.
Ini pula susulan khas pesawat back air di Kazakhstan. Pesawat berkenaan dilaporkan tergelincir dua kali.
Notifikasi berita ter.
Thanks so much for staying with Consider This. I'm Melisa Idris. With me is Sharaad Kuttan, and we're speaking tonight to former Minister of Foreign Affairs, Tan Sri Syed Hamid Albar. Tan Sri, so recently 90 ASEAN members of parliament and former elected representatives, they all expressed their concern over Malaysia's state of emergency. They urged for parliament to reconvene as soon as possible. However, that statement of concern has had some mixed reactions. Some, including those from your party, Bersatu's Supreme Council, have come out to cite foreign interference and a break from ASEAN's policy of non-interference. Where do you stand on this? Is this a matter of we can comment on other countries, but other countries cannot comment on us?
No, I think it is the very nature of international relations that you cannot avoid comments. You must be able to meet the comment and you must be able to react to it rather than saying, oh, this is interference. And we cannot, no man lives in an island now. You know, there is no such thing. You cannot live in, by yourself. You cannot live in isolation. You have other people around you or, you know, next to you. You have your neighbors, you have beyond your neighbors. So what we need to do is we must be open enough to be able to react to situation. If something is wrong, we cannot say there is not anything wrong. I mean, here, Malaysia is a parliamentary democracy. Other countries also face COVID. And they have also declared emergency. But there is no suspension of parliament, discussions are encouraged. I think this is the time that we have to, you know, because there are two points of view, even within political parties, within the legal, there's a lot of debate. You can, you know, you can argue both ways.
Tan Sri, do you support, Tan Sri, do you support the suspension of parliament?
I am a person who believes in parliamentary democracy to the fullest. So I think there are other options. You see, what we want to make sure, I think we have done quite well on COVID-19, you know, dealing with it, with COVID-19. Yes, the figures go up and we want to bring it down, we want to stabilize so that it becomes under control. But what we must avoid, the most important thing is, when we have the emergency, if you look at the, I think people like, you know, Shad Faruqi say it is justified because the Kalung Ningkan's case, to declare emergency. But the emergency must be focused on things that is to handle the pandemic or the epidemic. You know, it has to do with the COVID. It must not be seen as if we are trying to deny democracy or we are trying to exclude parliament. So all these things are not good, I think, in terms of our images, our, you know, image today, internationally. Right. We want to handle COVID, let us handle COVID. And I think we can handle COVID variant. We want to handle the question of livelihood. We want to all, but you know, when you are facing crisis like this, it is better for you to have more people to discuss, and it is better for us to engage more people so that everyone is brought together. We do not want to have, when we are facing this serious problem, that we are living in a very divided and pluralistic view where, you know, it's not helping us to overcome the problems that we are facing.
Speaking about the need for, you know, diverse views, more people to weigh in on this, I wanted to ask you about foreign missions today, like the U.S. Embassy and the British High Commission. They expressed concern over this morning's court's judgment against Malaysia King and that 500,000 ringgit fine. The foreign ministers, like the U.S. Embassy and the British High Com, they've come out to express concern over what they are calling a blow to freedom of press in the country. This regarding the Malaysia Kini case, that and they were fined $500,000 made to pay that fine within 3 working days. I'm wondering whether you welcome these statements of concerns from foreign missions like these, and whether you share their concerns about an erosion of freedom of speech and press.
There's a big question that you have asked. It requires a lot of time. But what I'm going to say is this. You know, you have to expect that. That should not be considered as interference. I think during my period as a foreign minister, I faced all kinds of foreign statements by embassies, by high commissions that differ from us. But we never fail to answer them. We need to respond. This is our court system. It is the law. You may not agree with our law. You know, you ask me, I think that's why I'm always concerned when there is an emergency law that can interfere. Because I was a home minister, I was criticized as a home minister. There's always a fear about interference with press freedom. And I think in today's world, you do that, definitely you will attract criticism. And when you attract criticism, we need to have an answer. We must answer. We cannot just say, oh, you shouldn't interfere. No. This is a thing that will attract attention. And 500,000 for Malaysia Kini for publishing is considered as interfering either with press freedom, or it is interfering with actual freedom of individual to give their views. So I think I'm not for interference. I've always taken the view, even during my period, I'm more for, I like people to have an open view, to be more transparent. I like to be engaged.
Tansri, I want to ask you about how serious this government is on diplomacy. The past president, Abdul Hadi Awang, was appointed special envoy to the Middle East. Bintulu MP was appointed special envoy to China, both with ministerial rank. Critics and maybe skeptics, I would say, well, these positions were given essentially to shore up the Perikata National Government. These were not serious attempts at diplomacy. What record do these two individuals have in advancing either our diplomacy in the Middle East or with China and the Far East?
I think, let me try to, you know, to paraphrase my answer so that it will not be very long. But I think what is not most important, it's not unusual for you to make a diplomat through political appointees. It's done by US, done by UK, done by other countries. But the most important thing is, we must, when during my period anyway, we always look how it will serve the interests of the country. You must remember that for diplomacy and foreign policy, is national interest. How would they be able to perform? If they're able to perform, it doesn't matter the personality or character. You must have, I'm very slow generally during my appoint non-diplomats. unless there is, you know, there is a positive contribution to enhancing either bilateral or multilateral relations, or we lack serving officers to not fulfill that. So we have the, you know, I was a special envoy of the OIC, for example, to Myanmar, because I had a role to play. There is a position that, so I think it is important to think about it. And we must always take public view, reputation of the person. We want to see how the person participates in issues affecting those regions or those countries that they are representing Malaysia. Because the idea is not just simply, and you know, it's very expensive when you appoint people with ministerial rank. Eh? And they have,
and so, Bansri, how would you say, you're well positioned to make an assessment, how do you say they have performed in the past year?
It's not fair for me to make an assessment of a person, because in the first place, I think you were mistaken to say that I'm an active politician. Actually, I'm more a retired politician than an active politician. I'm more an observer of events and issues, because my role was, I became a member and then I conducted the election. After the election, I no longer have any role in the party or in the PN. As far as
Tansri,
I'm concerned, I give
you remain a citizen, though. Tansri, can I ask you this? Are you happy with the direction this country has taken? We were once the outlier in a region that was sliding back into authoritarianism. We had that democratic breakthrough. The story that Malaysia is telling the world today is not a very happy one. It's one of volatility, confusion, and paralysis. Are you happy with this country, where this country is going?
I think at this time, if you asking the question whether I'm happy or not happy, I think this is the time that the government must be seen to be proactive and active, so that, you know, Sharaad and Melisa, they will be able to engage you. They should be able to engage and debate with you why they have taken this position. And you cannot just, by keeping quiet, it doesn't give you the answer. I think at present, what people want, there are two things that is important. I would like to see that the image of Malaysia is seen, image and the perception of Malaysia is positive. And, you know, two is that there must be, people must be able to feel confident that there is political stability. Three, the government that is in power is seen, rightly or wrongly, to have legitimacy. This is all the issues that we need to answer. This is the time, in my view, that your communication ministry, the government's communication ministry, must be very strong, and foreign ministry must be very strong. You cannot just simply not answering and not wanting people to interfere. Even our netizens today are very, very vocal and critical, and they want you to be doing your work. You cannot be doing something extracurricular in order to show that, you know. I think if you see the life on the street, or there's so many issues. The government has helped, but what we want to see is sustainability, their livelihood, you know, you give money, but that money is not the answer. It's the sustainability of that money and livelihood is important. So I think there are a lot of things that I think the government has to be more open, more willing to face criticism and and engage people, engage others, not only one point of view. So you ask me, I would say that I am not you know, I am not involved within. If you want to know my view, you can see a lot of the things, my views of how happy or not happy I am on the tweet that I make or in my Facebook.
Yes. We do follow you on social media. We hear you on social media. Thank you, Tansri, for speaking with us tonight. We appreciate your time.
It's very
That's
very
all we have for you.
Thank you.
That's all we have for you on this episode of Consider This. But before we leave you, just a reminder that you can get all the latest news and information on COVID-19 on COVID-19 updates on our Astro AWANI website, astroawani.com, as well as the Astro AWANI app. But for tonight, I'm Melisa Idris.
And I'm Sharaad Kuttan, signing off for the evening.
Thank you so much for watching and good night.